many of you knit? Anybody in here? Okay. Do you knit, man? You totally have to teach him, right? So God loves to knit. Let's start with prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Today we're going to talk about how much God loves to knit. But first, how many of you grew up with more than one sibling in your family? Okay, did anybody not? Was anybody an only child? Okay, all right. How many of you will admit that you were your parents' favorite child? Okay, how many of you will know beyond a shadow of a doubt that somebody else was your parents' favorite child? Okay, for me, I came from a large family, and my parents were too busy to have a favorite child. I know that's not true for every large family, but in my family it was. Sometimes natural parents do have a favorite child. They might not admit it, but it's true. Do you remember this mother's words?
Yes, I did.
Yeah. Remember Tommy was the one who always told Vic, Mom always liked you best. And look at the difference in terms of what they've been given, right? And you know, it happened in Scripture too. The older brother of the prodigal son accused his father of favoring the younger brother. And wasn't Martha really accusing Jesus of favoring Mary when she complained to him about how Mary was behaving? Do you ever look around at your brothers and sisters in the family of God and think to yourself, you know, God loves them more than he loves me. They're his favorite. He's given them more spiritual, emotional, physical, intellectual, whatever gifts than he's given to me. He listens to them. He answers their prayers. He doesn't listen to me no matter what I do. God loves them best. You ever think that? But you know, his word tells us that he doesn't have any favorites. After all, we are each created by him in his image. He loves every one of us with the same incredibly overwhelming love. As a matter of fact, he's crazy in love with us, with each one of us, as if there were only one of us. Listen to his word from Psalm 139. Let it sink deeply into your spirit. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book. Before one of them came to be. God knit you together in your mother's womb, and he doesn't drop any stitches. God loves to knit. Today we're going to learn a little bit more about who we are, about who Jesus is, see ourselves in scriptural personalities, hopefully laugh, and go home with some practical ideas about how to put what we've learned into practice. And it's going to be fun, okay? It's going to be fun. God knits. He loves to knit. Psalm 139 tells us that, and he must love to knit because, you know, our world population today is over 7 billion people, and he created a lot of people before we even got here. When God knits, he uses a special and unique pattern for each one of us. Even though we are each created in his image, he loves variety. God puts a different combination of traits, characteristics, talents, and gifts in each one of us, in each pattern he knits. And he created each one of us to reflect a different, unique nugget of who he is. That's kind of cool, you know, when you look around and you think each one of us carries a little bit different piece of God. The Bible reveals God's total interest in each one of us as he knits. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Each individual pattern is fearfully and wonderfully knit. God knew you and joyfully planned for you, even before you were born. Think about that. Then and now, he has plans for you, just you. Plans that only you can accomplish. Each plan, no matter the size, is vitally essential to God. And the more you know what makes you a unique individual, the better you can understand how loved you are and how to bring your unique God nugget of love to others. We can look at so many aspects of our uniqueness, but today we're going to focus on where God has put you on the extrovert-introvert spectrum. How many of you think you're an extrovert? Yeah, extroverts will raise their hand. We have one. How many of you think, okay, two. Oh, right. Three. Yes, three, four. Okay, this is getting better. How many of you think you're probably an introvert? So the extrovert raises her hand. Yeah, thanks. Okay. Lots of people think it works like this. Extroversion relates to how outgoing someone is. Introversion is the same as being shy. Is that what you think? Kind of? Like, does that make sense? But introversion and extroversion actually relate to where we get our energy from, or in other words, how we recharge our brains. Extroverts gain energy from other people. They actually find their energy is sapped when they spend too much time alone. They recharge by being social. For the extroverts, that makes sense? Who knows? We'll keep going. Introverts, on the other hand, tend to recharge by spending time alone. They lose energy by being around people for long periods of time, particularly large crowds. But nobody's a pure introvert or a pure extrovert. Everyone has their unique, God-given combination of introversion, extroversion, knit into who they are. Let's start by looking a little more closely at extroverts. How are we doing? Nope, one before. Yep, that one. So, extroverts like variety and action. They enjoy being around and get energized by people, and they learn better if experience and action comes before theory. Now, what that means is they want to do it first and then read the directions. Does anybody know what we're talking about there? Okay, they talk first and maybe think later. They have a lot of close friends. They enjoy reading or talking with the TV or stereo on or plugged in. They're easily approached, but sometimes then they tend to take over the conversation. You know, back in the days when we had landlines, when the phone would ring, it would be the extroverts who would run to get the phone when it rang. And the introverts would say, oh, I hope somebody else will get that phone. They like meetings and getting their opinions across. They find listening more difficult than talking. They look with their mouths, not with their eyes. So you hear everything that they see because they'll tell you about it. And they really like affirmation about who they are, what they do, how they look. They really like affirmation. Extroverts bring energy and life to the body of Christ. But there are pitfalls. They think out loud. They shoot from the lip, and they may think they can talk their way out of anything. Okay, if you're not an extrovert, do you know anybody in your family who is? Maybe a kid that you have to just be aware of. This is an interesting one. They become louder in conflict situations. They say a lot, but don't remember what was said. We'll talk a little bit more when we're talking about introverts about arguing, okay, because who wins a fight? They may sound angry when they're not. Anybody ever accused you extroverts of being angry and where'd that come from? Their growing edge, what they need to do is learn how to stop, look, and listen. Stop talking, look at others, and listen to what they're saying. It's not easy, but with God, all things are possible. Let's look at who is an extrovert in Scripture. Now, this is kind of cool. Go back one, just for a second, Doug, please, thanks. Let's look at who is an extrovert in Scripture. It's important to remember that these people are real people. They were extroverts and introverts. They had good habits, bad habits, warts, bad hair days. But, you know, all sorts of unique characteristics that only God knows about for sure. But there are a few hints that we can pick up from Scripture about Bible characters, personalities, and temperaments. And now, let's look at Peter. Peter is one of the Bible's heroes, and he's our extrovert that we're going to be looking at today. He was outspoken, he was an ardent disciple, enthusiastic, strong-willed, impulsive, and at times he was brash. He was impetuous to the point of rashness. Look at all these things he did. He was the guy that got out of the boat, he walked on the water. You think an introvert would do that? Probably not. He took Jesus aside. I can't believe this when you really think about it. He took Jesus aside and rebuked him because Jesus was speaking about his coming death. When he was on the Mount of Transfiguration with the other two disciples, there was a lull. There was glory over Elijah, Moses, and Jesus, and then there was a lull, and Peter had to say something. An extrovert finds it really hard to have silence. And so he suggested erecting three tabernacles, three tents, to honor Moses, Elijah, and Jesus. He actually drew his sword and attacked the high priest's servant, cut off his ear. Jesus repaired it. He boasted that he would never forsake the Lord, even if everyone else did. And yet, with all of this, he's one of the Bible's heroes, and God knit Peter together in his mother's womb. God loves to knit, and he doesn't drop any stitches. Jesus sees us as he intends us to be. In every situation Peter got himself into, Jesus taught, forgave, grew Peter. He saw Peter as he intended him to be. In Matthew 16:18, Jesus called Peter who he would be as if he were already that. Before he had done most of these things, Jesus said, "I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." Let's go on to introverts. Okay. Introverts can be tricky to understand. It's so easy to assume that introversion is the same as shyness, but it's not. Introverts are simply people who find it tiring to be around other people. They tend to be quiet and reserved. They prefer time alone for reflection and to sustain energy. And they relate inwardly to people and the world. They learn better with concepts first. They pore over the instructions before they do anything. They think first and maybe talk later. They enjoy small groups of friends. They need time alone to recharge. They're labeled shy, reserved, reflective. They're great listeners, but they might end up feeling used. They want to get ideas across more forcefully, but they're seen as having little to say. They hate being interrupted. They believe that talk is cheap, so sometimes they're a little bit suspicious of compliments. Introverts bring depth and reflection to the body of Christ. And remember again that this is a whole spectrum. So nobody is a pure extrovert, nobody is a pure introvert. You're someplace along the line. And a lot of us end up being more in the middle, don't we, than either extrovert or introvert. But it's interesting just when you're out in the world, just to be aware of this and to be aware of the fact that God loves knitting and he has knit each one of us in a different way. The pitfalls for introverts. Sometimes they will shut off any communication that could lead to resolution. They may find it redundant and energy draining to tell their side of the story, and they end up feeling invisible and resentful. One of the growing edges that introverts are called to look at is learning how to tell their side of the story as often as they have to in order to be heard. Because introverts remember that your side of the story is a nugget of God. And so you need to be able to tell that story to the rest of the body of Christ. It's not easy. But with God, all things are possible. Now let's look at a scriptural introvert. Moses, again, our Bible hero. When God told him that he was to bring God's people out of Egypt, Moses came up with five, not just one, but five excuses why he shouldn't be the one to do it. Excuses that God basically ran roughshod over and told him he was the one chosen. His first one was, "Who am I that I should go?" He said this to God, "Who am I that I should go? I'm a nobody. Like, how can you possibly pick me?" God said to him, "I will be with you. End of story." "Well, what if they ask me your name?" "Well," God said, "then you just tell them my name. My name is I am who I am. I am who sent you." "Well," number three, "what if they don't believe me or listen to me?" And how many of you have ever thought that? You know, you have a little niggling thought that you need to encourage somebody, but, oh, that's really kind of strange. "What if they don't believe me or listen to me?" Well, God gave Moses three signs and wonders that he could use. And if you want to know what they are, it's in Exodus 3. You can go and read that later. We don't have time right now. Number four. And Moses is being really, you know, "Oh God, I have to come before you and I have to be humble here. Pardon me. Pardon your servant, Lord. I've never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you've spoken to your servant. I'm slow of speech and tongue." Anybody ever felt that way? Sort of. Anybody ever sort of felt that way? You did an amazing job, Danielle. Didn't she do a great job? Like, seriously. Wonderful. God basically said to Moses, "Who was it that knit you together in your mother's womb? I chose you. Now go. I will help you speak and teach you what you have to say." Number five, Moses finally said, "Pardon your servant, Lord, please send somebody else." God finally got a bit peeved. Actually, scripture says his anger burned. But what he did was, he said, "Okay, I'm going to send Aaron to be with you. Aaron will be the person who talks. I'll tell you what to say to Aaron. You tell Aaron what to say to the people, and Aaron will say that to the people." And Moses didn't have any choice. He went. You know, God loves to knit. God knit Moses together in his mother's womb, and he doesn't drop any stitches. Jesus sees us as he intends us to be. He saw Moses as he intended him to be. And hear what Jesus said about Moses to the Jewish leaders. He said, "If you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. But since you don't believe what he wrote, how are you going to believe what I say?" Moses knew Jesus well enough to write about him. He knew him really well. Another interesting thing about all of this is, you know, Moses wrote the first five books of the Old Testament. Probably not the part where it talks about his death, but other than that, he wrote the first five books. And he did a lot of writing. Peter the extrovert did a lot of talking. God knit you, each one of us, together in our mother's wombs. He loves to knit, and he doesn't drop any stitches. So how many of you think that you can relate a little bit more to Peter? Anybody? Okay, a few of you, a little couple of little hands going up here. How about to Moses? A few of you? Yeah, especially with the beard. Oh my gosh, eh? So what's this mean tomorrow? What's this mean for Monday morning? I think there are two main things to remember. The first one is that Jesus is not finished with us yet, or with anyone we come in contact with. He honors and loves us just where we are, and honors and loves us enough not to let us stay there. When we look at how he worked in the lives of Moses and Peter, we can see that he wants to overcome our fears, he wants to forgive our unfaithfulness, he patiently teaches us. And he sees us as he intends us to be, not as we are necessarily. And he also uses unlikely heroes in unlikely ways. How many of you are heroes? Honestly. Like, if you really, Daniel, all right, yeah. Excellent, Santa Claus. This is, you know, the thing is that we are all God's unlikely heroes. That's what we're called to be. And to recognize and to walk forward in that is really important. He sees in us what we can't see in ourselves. The second thing to remember is that we're called to honor and love ourselves. and how we're knit together and those who have different personality types than we do. God doesn't play favorites with any one personality. He created them all. 1 Corinthians 12 reminds us that the body of Christ would be woefully incomplete if one member suddenly stopped sharing their nugget of God's love. This goes for extroverts and introverts alike. Don't demand that others be like you. Don't compare yourself to others, and don't judge them. Or yourself. Don't judge yourself. Celebrate who you are. Celebrate the way that God has actually knit you together. Here are some practical ways to honor extroverts and introverts. We'll start with the extrovert line over here, the column. Respect their independence. They really like to do things by themselves in a lot of ways. They like to think. Compliment them in public. This is an interesting one. They really need encouragement. Accept and encourage their enthusiasm. The body of Christ needs the enthusiasm of extroverts. Allow them to talk things out, even though it sometimes seems they go on forever. However, remember that they think out loud, and so sometimes that's how they have to work things through. And to challenge them a little bit, encourage quiet times. For introverts, respect their need for privacy. Never embarrass them in public. Don't demand instant answers, and this is where arguing comes in. If you're in an argument with an extrovert and an introvert, who would win if it was just an upfront argument? The extrovert would win, wouldn't he? Or she, right? Because they've got all the words right on the tip of their tongue. But watch out. What happens with the introvert is everything, all the information comes in, it goes down here, something happens in here, and 3 days later, they'll come back to you and they'll say, you know that argument that you thought you won? It's not over yet. So don't demand instant answers. Don't interrupt them, and challenge them. Invite them to small groups or maybe even a little bit of a larger group. You know, the reality is we're in this together. We're each created exactly the way God planned, and we are each a vital member of his family, of the body of Christ. We're so loved. Jesus told us we are called to love, didn't he? He said 2 commandments, love God, love your neighbor as yourself. We're to love God, we're to love others, and we're to love ourselves. There is no one else who can love the way that you do, wherever you are on the extrovert-introvert spectrum. There is no one else that can give the world the unique nugget of God's love that he has knit within you. Who are you to deprive the world of that precious gift of love? God loves to knit. God knit each of us together in our mother's wombs, and he doesn't drop any stitches. Let's pray. Father, thank you that we're your kids, knit together by your loving hands. Thank you for making each one of us unique and special. Help us to learn to receive your love, to enter into it deeply, and to share it with others more each day. In Jesus' name, amen.